Hello, I'm Chuck Young. Welcome to Eternity Now. Today we've got a special guest, Gene Boros. Gene is the founder and publisher for a street paper here in Nashville called Unity Faith. Gene, it's so good to have you here, man.
Faith Unity.
Oh, thank you for correcting me on that. Faith Unity. I think I like Faith Unity that much more, you know?
Right, yeah.
Yeah, tell us a little bit about yourself, where you're from and, you know, where you were raised and how you found yourself in Nashville.
Actually, I'm from West Kentucky, Paducah, Kentucky, and I had a business I ran there and really just felt God calling me to step off into ministry and came to Nashville and still lost, didn't know what he wanted me to do, and then of course he put the publication, which originally started out just to get the gospel into the streets, and then it just kind of just grew from there to, you know, helping the low income and homeless that are out on the streets, and so God really just kind of just blew it up from that point.
Now, you knew the Lord before you came to Nashville, though.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
Were you just raised as a Christian, or
yes,
is that
I was.
Something you came into?
No, I was raised as a Christian. There's been times in my life where I didn't live Christ-like, and I think many people find themselves there. And then you just kind of get to a point in life where you kind of realize everything else you've done has, you know, been a failure, and I never really didn't really make God center of anything. It was more of a, hey, look what I've done type things. And it really just set in on me one day, you know, hey, I wouldn't have been able to accomplish anything, or even my failures even wouldn't have, because I grow from my failures. But without any of that taking place, you know, and God teaching me through that, you know, I wouldn't have never been where I was.
When you first came to Nashville, and I suppose started working here, how long was it before you started thinking along the lines of putting a street paper out there like Faith Unity?
Well, about 7 or 8 months. I kept looking for what ministry he wanted me to get into and how he wanted me to serve. And then when he gave me the answer, I like denied it and ran from it. It's like, no, it's not that. You know, you pick something else.
Uh-huh.
You know, so that's when, of course, when I found out and, you know, really figured out God just wants our availability. You know, he can, if it's his thing, I mean, he's going to give you what you need to make it happen. And he's done just that. I mean, so many times that I have so little faith, thinking, God, how are you going to pull this off? I don't know, you know, where we're going to get the money this month. I don't know how I'm going to get people to sell it. I don't know how, you know, in me, I didn't know. But of course, he already had that all laid out and planned out and figured out. And you know, the
sure.
more that I did, you know, stayed with it, and I mean, of course, there's times I wanted to give up, thinking, "Oh, I'm not the one. I can't do this. It's too much. It's too big. It's, you know, it's just me." And then I realized it's not just me. It's me and him. Actually, it's him and then me. So once I really kind of let that settle in, that's when God really just started taking it leaps and bounds, and he still tests my faith along the way, but my faith has just grown just. Learning just to sit back, not really sit back, but just really just trusting God. Now, hey, he's got it. I mean, I don't have to, you know, stress over things and like I was. And now I realize I just kind of take it. He says he gives our daily bread, so I take it daily. You know, now I'm just kind of on the fly with it.
You know, you were here, you said, for about 6 or 7 months, and then it was about a year and a half ago, I think you told me earlier, a year and a half ago is when you first really started putting this thing together. Is that about when the time was?
Right, it was. We're about a year and a half old, though we are only in our 13th, coming up 14th issue. The first several months was really slow. I mean, that's the times when I thought, man, this ain't it. I took it all wrong. This ain't what he wants me to do. You know, and I just thought that's what it was, but really it wasn't that. He was really just, I think he was just pruning me and testing me and, you know, making sure that, you know, not making sure, but letting me see that I'm willing to stay with it myself.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that God tests us like that. But, you know, as I got into it and when I when I wanted to run away, that's when I, you know, really had to just pray harder and longer and, you know, begin the fast and just, you know, really seek God's will and guidance. And because when you're doing something, when you completely jump out of the box, and that's what a lot of people are afraid to do these days, is step up and step out. And I think that we kind of put God in a box by not doing that, because I think we should be bold and audacious in our serving of God. Mm-hmm. And I think doing that, I have, definitely, because there's some times that I thought, man, God, I mean, I imagine Moses, you know, standing at the sea when, you know, thinking, oh, what do I do next? You know, and then God parts the waters, you know, and I've felt like I've been in that position with this publication. You know, I felt like I'm standing at the waters waiting to see what God's going to do next. But wow. He always pulls off something miraculous that I can just stand there and just shake my head at and think, God, you're so big. I couldn't have done that if I wanted to.
Well, you know, I know a lot of our viewers have, you know, they're familiar with the papers that they see, you know, being sold out on the streets where you've got some people. Some of those people are homeless sometimes, some are not, but, you know, they're selling, you know, these different newspapers out there and making a little bit of money so they can buy their food or whatever they need to have just to sustain themselves, which is a great thing.
Right.
The one thing that's different about your street paper, why don't you tell us a little bit about that?
Well, first of all, the main thing most people will notice is we're full color. So
sure are.
The thing is, a lot of the vendors, they actually will sell the publication like this. So you'll see them, they'll fold it in half. So you can always recognize the Faith Unity. And of course, we always have our price big enough that, you know, that you can see it.
It's $1.
And, yeah, that's right. Here, this next, over the course of the next month, all the badges are yellow, so our badges are turning to like a neon green, so you'll be able to quickly identify just by the badge that, hey, that's one of them Christian papers right over there. I can see the badge.
Now, when you say a badge, it's a badge that they wear on their shirt? Or
some of them wear it on a shirt, but they have like a lanyard, and it's about okay. Half the size of the paper there, you know, and it just hangs on them, and it just lets the person know that they are with Faith Unity as far as an independent contractor, that they're not, you know, just peddling papers.
It's not one of the other newspapers that's out there selling around Nashville.
Right. And another thing, you know, so we know, and the police knows that we know who we have out there selling, you know, the publication, that we have their ID, and, you know, we know a little bit about them. Mm-hmm. And, of course, we can't know everything. And honestly, with this publication, I really... when I first started doing this, I used to try to pick and choose who I thought was okay or good enough to sell papers. And even with that, God taught me a lesson. I mean, God wants us to come to Him as we are. I mean, He takes us as we are. Mm-hmm. And then He shapes us and molds us over a period of time. And that's what I found Him doing even through this publication. I mean, they come to us, they come to us completely broken, and maybe some of them are still battling addiction. But this is just one step of getting the gospel in front of them, you know, that they can read it, that even selling the publication, it opens up as a conversation piece, you know, for the people in the community. Oh, that's a Christian paper. Do you know the Lord? And, mm-hmm. And of course, we work with them as they come by papers, and I go check. I mean, I even go under the bridge, you know, or wherever they're staying, or to the woods, and, you know, and just let them know I care. I come to their house like I go to my friends, because they are my friends. I mean, really, they've mm-hmm. become like a family to me.
Sure.
So we have a good relationship.
You know, you were mentioning that one of the things that definitely distinguishes your paper is the, you know, the beautiful artwork and the four-color printing. And the other facet is that it is a Christian paper with Christian content. Now, when somebody buys one of the Faith Unity papers, what kind of article can they expect, or advertising even, can they expect to see in that paper?
Yeah, we try to theme out our articles, so we usually try to have a testimony, but then we'd like to give biblical views from several different writers that we have all across the country. For instance, this issue here, if you see, is Catching Fire. And basically, so many different aspects of catching fire. I mean, just being on fire for God and being able to set a fire. Yeah, being able to set a fire and being used to set a fire in someone else. And just a few issues ago, we had Gracism. which was basically racism, what the Bible has to say about race and grace. So we like to hit on tough subjects that a lot of people don't like to hit on. Several issues ago, we even had a real suicide letter from a 15-year-old kid that had hung himself in his garage. And the parents allowed us to publish the note that he had actually written. And the reason that we'd done that is it was my first time ever even reading a suicide letter. And I'm telling you, I bawled like a baby. I mean, it tore me up inside, just the thought that he didn't have anywhere else to go, that there wasn't any, he didn't feel like he had anyone to talk to. And so just bringing that awareness to people, hey, people are hurting. I mean, you may not be able to, people are good at putting a front of how they feel, and really inside they're broken, they're torn to shreds. And that's the nice thing about this publication too. You don't never know what hand they're gonna get put into. I mean, someone's having a bad day, they see someone out, they hand someone a dollar, and then they get the gospel in return. And I mean, we've got many letters and phone calls and emails of people saying, hey, you just have no idea how that impacted my day today. I mean, I was having a bad day, and I've had some issues in my life, and I was going to help somebody out with a dollar, and they gave me this publication. This really blessed me. I mean, there was an article in there that just really just changed my whole perspective on my day, and maybe even in their whole life. So it's really been a powerful tool.
You know, I actually remember purchasing one of those papers one day, and the girl told me that it was a Christian newspaper, which I thought was really interesting, because, you know, some of the others out there, or none of the others as far as I know, are a Christian-based newspaper that's trying to get the word out there like you're doing. What a wonderful idea, and how the Lord has moved on you to do this. And you've been doing it for now about a year and a half. You've got 13 or 14 different publications, you said. I think it's just a wonderful way to get the gospel out there. And God bless you, man, for coming down to Nashville, and praise God that He's given you a vision to spread His word, you know, and give you a good vocation to make a living. I mean, what a great way to do that.
Amen.
That's man. Right. You know, it's a good thing that we've got someone like Gene Boris here in Nashville that's cried out to God, and the Lord has answered him with a way to bring God's Word to all the people out there. What a wonderful thing you're doing, Gene. Thank you so much for being with us today.
Amen. Thank you for inviting me.
Thank you for being here at Eternity Now. We'll see you next time. God bless you. Hello. You might really enjoy The Great Hope. This little book gives you an inside look at the great controversy between Christ and His angels and Satan and his angels that's waging on earth right now. If you'd like a free copy of this, you can order it from www.health-hope.org. It's a book that you'll never forget, and you'll really enjoy it. Today on Eternity Now, we've got a very special guest, and he's a familiar guest, Keith Noel. Keith is the evangelist trainer for the Kentucky-Tennessee Conference of Seventh-day Adventists. Keith, thank you for coming back. Man, it is so good to have
it's
you back on here.
Yeah, it's good to
see you
here.
Too. You know, I'm so glad that Keith is here with me today, because we're going to be going over Halloween, Harry Potter, and Twilight series. These are some things that have infiltrated our society, and we're going to take a look at it from a biblical perspective and just see exactly what maybe the devil has in mind with some of these things that are going on. Halloween. Keith, what on earth prompted everybody to go on this Halloween craze and spend so much money dressing up like goblins and Frankenstein, and in some cases, Princess and Big Bird?
Yeah, it goes back to the Celtic culture, and they were big worshipers of nature, and this was the beginning of their new year, and it was a time where of their harvest as well, and the nights were getting longer, the days were growing shorter, and they said this was the time of the year when that line between the living and dead was at its thinnest, and the dead could come back and visit you.
You know, it's interesting how that this holiday has found its way into Christianity. And it still seems to be surrounding the spirits of the dead. Have you got any information?
All Saints Day.
Yeah, have you got any information about that?
About the 8th century, the Roman Catholic Church, they wanted to honor the saints that weren't already mentioned and recognized. And so this would include all those saints that weren't mentioned or weren't recognized, and to honor them. Some feel like it's gone to almost to the line of worshiping the saints, and that's why some Protestants, or all Protestants, have stayed away from All Saints Day.
Yes, well, it's also interesting how it's in our Christian society now, but it still maintains all of the, darker paganistic aspects that seem to have brought it about in the first place. Kind of a blending of Christianity with paganism, which, of course, we know from some of the studies we've done on here that during the Dark Ages and through the Roman Church, there was a lot of blending of paganism and Christianity, and Halloween is kind of a perfect example of that with All Hallowed Saints Day. And being a Bible scholar like you are, there's probably nothing in the Bible that even vaguely resembles Halloween or a call to worship the saints or have a special day of honor for them.
Certainly that I'm not aware of. In fact, the only one that deserves our worship, and the Bible is clear on this, is God and His Son, Jesus Christ, and the Holy Spirit. God is the only one that deserves our worship. And if we worship anything else, we've broken the first commandment that says we shouldn't have any idols before us.
Oh, that is so well put. There's another aspect of Halloween that's even darker than just the blending of paganism with Christianity, and that is that the occultist, Satanism in particular, they hold this day in high esteem.
It's the second most important holiday in the Satanist calendar.
It seems like I've read some things about Satanism where this is a time, especially a time of bloodletting sacrifices that Satanists indulge in at that time, and also even things of a sexual nature are taking place along with those, abominable things.
Well, there's been a lot of talk in the past about that, and there certainly could be. Back in the late 80s, throughout the 90s to about 1995, there was a lot of talk and almost to a sense a scare that humans, blonde-haired, blue-eyed women were being kidnapped and things and sacrificed. But there is no record of it, really, when it comes to law enforcement. They have, if there has been some type of sacrifices and things of that nature going on, it hasn't been much more than the regular activity that's out there. And so anyway, I'm not saying that it doesn't have its dark side, and it definitely does have its dark side, but I don't think we should be imitating any of the things that we dress up to be, typically dressed up to be anyhow.
You've heard a lot of Christians say that, if you're a Christian, you maybe really should just not indulge in Halloween, that it may be a good idea just to abstain from that holiday because of the nature of it.
I think that's true. Now, I'll share with you why. Like Dracula, let's take Dracula for a second. Where did that story come from? A man named Bram Stoker back in 1897, I believe it was. And there was a real Dracula. There was a real castle of Dracula. And this guy was called Vlad the Impaler. And he impaled, at least to some historical records, 100,000 people on a pole, burning them as torches. The part about the blood comes from another source, Elizabeth, let me see my little notes here, Elizabeth Bathory. She was also called the Blood Countess. She was probably the most prolific female serial killer in history. She killed 100 girls bathed in virgin's blood because she believed that that would keep her young. And that's where that, drinking the blood, keeping young comes from. I mean, that's, the facts of where Dracula came from.
So anybody that's like following after that is in essence kind of giving that a certain homage that it just doesn't deserve.
Well, you know, people say, come on, we're just dressing up in costumes. It's just a symbol or whatever. How about if I take down the cross at my church and put up a great big Nazi sign? It's just a symbol. I mean, who cares, you know?
That's a good sample of, you know, why people might consider not doing that. You know, there's some other things that have entered into American culture very recently, too, that I'd like to discuss while we're going over some of those dark side topics, and that's Harry Potter. You know, there's the Harry Potter series that took the country just by storm. This lady, her name is... J.K. Rowling. And J.K. Rowling actually... she was on a train trip, and this idea just came over her in a very overwhelming way that she had to write this series of books. And in this series of books, it's about Harry Potter, whose parents, ironically, were murdered on Halloween by, you know, the dastardly character in the books. And it's all about him going to this school of witchcraft called Hogwarts and developing all the crafts of witchcraft. And, you know, the Bible actually has quite a bit to say about witchcraft.
Have you
got some scriptures that we could reference on that?
Yes, I do. There's some powerful scriptures here on that. Let me just share with you a few of those. Here's one from Galatians chapter 5, beginning with verse 19. It says, "Now the works of the flesh are manifest, which are these: adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lasciviousness, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred." Then it goes on with all these other ones, but I want to mention witchcraft here. And it says that those that do such things will not enter the kingdom of God. In Revelation, it repeats it in Revelation 21, verse 8, "But the cowardly, unbelieving, abominable, murderers, sexual, immoral, sorcerers, they will have to die the second death," it says in Revelation 21, verse 8. And Revelation 22, verse 15, again, it mentions sorcerers, compares them to dogs, and how they will suffer the vengeance of eternal fire.
You know, there's another series, the Twilight series, that, you know, we can relate back to the Dracula story, because the Twilight series was written by a lady named Stephanie Meyer, and she had a dream in which she saw the characters, this vampire character, along with a young girl, and she was just obsessed with it. She was just a housewife and a mother of two, I believe, and she began to write this book, this series of books, Twilight, and there is an example of this dark side Dracula-type character, a vampire, in the form of a modernized book that has just made her millions and millions of dollars, and they've made movies out of it, and so many people are following after these things. Of course, also the Harry Potter series. You know, I read that Ms. Rowling is one of the richest people in the United Kingdom right now, with $1 billion that she's made off of selling.
She's not a millionaire, she's a billionaire.
She's a billionaire now.
Yeah.
So people are making really big money off of these occultic content books, and ushering people in to understand these darker things that the Bible plainly condemns.
Right.
You know, there's plenty of scriptures. I believe there's some in Deuteronomy also that talk about and condemn witchcraft as an abomination.
Yes, whether it comes to Halloween, dressing up like dragons, vampires, whatever, ghosts and goblins, you know, the Bible says that our God is not a God of fear. And
that's
this
right.
Promotes fear, the spirit of fear. And here in the book of Deuteronomy 18, it says, "Be very careful not to imitate the detestable customs of the nations living there. For example, never sacrifice your son or daughter as a burnt offering, and do not let your people practice fortune telling or use sorcery or interpret omens or engage in witchcraft or cast spells or function as mediums, psychics, or call forth the spirits of the dead. Anyone who does these things is detestable to the Lord. It is because
of other nations have done these detestable things, that the Lord your God will drive them out ahead of you. You must be blameless before the Lord your God. The nations you are about to displace consult sorcerers and fortune tellers, but the Lord your God forbids you to do such things. The Bible calls it an abomination. Now, if a sorcerer, if witchcraft is an abomination, why would we want to imitate those things when it clearly says, be careful not to imitate those things? And that's not me thinking. This is what the Bible says. And so why would we want to imitate something that God says is an abomination?
You know, there's been a lot written out there about these books, and there's one man who was involved heavily with witchcraft and Satanism all of his life, and he came to know the Lord Jesus Christ and had his sins forgiven. And after the fact, he is speaking openly about the content of the Harry Potter books, that those books are nothing but a guideline to witchcraft, and that even the names within there that are used, the characters within the books, are the actual names of demons that he himself was familiar with when he was involved with witchcraft. So Ms.
And
Rowling,
she even confessed in one of her own interviews that a third of it is, you know, what Wicca believes in and teaches. And
so there's no doubt that it really is witchcraft and an introduction. And the sad thing is that a lot of young people are indulgent in that and are finding out at a very young age. And I'll tell you, I've talked to some people that's gotten involved with these things. Once you start that cycle, it's very hard to get out of it. And it does affect people's mindset.
Absolutely. You know, Wicca says on their sites that the sales have increased. The books, you go into the bookstores, there's whole sections on witchcraft and things of this nature. There's a great interest out there like never before. Books on witchcraft is selling like it's never sold before. And they all contributed to Harry Potter and some of these type of
That's right. Harry Potter and Twilight both set records in book sales and in movie sales when they first came out. You know, Keith, it is so good to have you back on the show again to go over this ominous subject here on Halloween. You know, I'm so glad you were here, man. I hope you'll come back again.
Hey, God bless you, and it's good to always be here.
Oh, it really is. Thank you guys for being here today, and we hope you come back again. God bless you.